Do you remember what we did yesterday?
Yes, ma'am. It's paper chromatography.
Ma'am, we separated the components of a mixture.
Yes, and today we are going to learn about another technique of chromatography, which is based on adsorption, right? And here we are going to do two types of experiments, one using a thin layer chromatography and another using a column chromatography. Both of them are very interesting experiments, and we will first start with the thin layer chromatography. So as the name reflects, thin layer chromatography of course is there. So what is this thin layer about? You must be curious to know this.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you still remember that we used two terms? One is stationary phase and another is
mobile phase,
right? So here the stationary phase again is a solid support. Solid means solid silica gel. Here the solid support used is silica gel, which you can see is placed in this beaker. I have a solvent here, which is water, in this beaker, and you can see that these are the components of the mixtures we are kept here. There are three tubes and there are two mixtures and one reference compound. So I'll explain when we will actually perform this separation. And you can also see here two glass plates, right? What we will do is that we can either prepare TLC plates, thin layer chromatography plates, by coating the silica gel, first dissolving the silica gel in this water, dipping these plates in that, and you will find that there will be a coating of silica gel on these plates, but that will be wet. We will dry those plates in the oven, and then these plates will be ready for use for thin layer chromatography. And we also get ready-made plates from the market as well. And these are the samples of plates which we get ready from the market. There is a chart, sort of a plate, like you can say 20 by 20 centimeters piece of metal, on which silica gel is already coated and dried. So these are ready to use silica gel plates. So this is one sample of it. I will be needing a scale and a pencil to mark a reference line on these plates, and I have a gloss rod here to just mix these silica gel and water to make it a perfect solution that way. And then we will, after preparing this sort of initial setup, go for actual separation of the components of the mixture. I have also shown here the kind of spots we place on the reference line here.
Ma'am, what is this reference line?
Reference line is actually the baseline on which we actually place the spots of the mixture which is to be separated. That gives us a sort of zero marking, that when we'll be calculating RF, that how much a spot or the component has traveled, we'll be using this line as a baseline or reference line or a zero line, and we will calculate the distance or measure the distance starting from this point. And here I have got this cork which is having a hook, and with which we now hook this small strip of plate, which is thin layer chromatography plate coated with silica gel, and this is a plate now ready for separation. What we will do, we will put this plate in the development chamber and see how the separation of different components take place. So this is the basic preparation you will be needing to start with any chromatography experiment which is based on thin layer chromatography. So any other question you have still in mind, you can ask, and then we will actually go for how to perform this experiment. We will start that.
Ma'am, how do these components get separated?
Right. The question is really good, because you remember in paper chromatography we performed in the earlier session, the mechanism was partition. But here the mechanism will be
adsorption,
because the name is adsorption chromatography, and under which we will be doing experiments based on thin layer chromatography and column chromatography. So adsorption is there, so components are first of all adsorbed on this thin layer on silica gel, which is the adsorbent, right? And we have a mobile phase also, and it will depend that which component is more soluble in mobile phase, that will be carried along with the mobile phase in a much faster rate, right? So if we have a mixture, maybe there are two components or three components, then the component which is more soluble in the mobile phase will be carried along with the mobile phase. It will reach to a greater height, you will see in this experiment, along with the mobile phase as compared to another component which is lesser soluble in the mobile phase but more strongly adsorbed on the silica gel. So it's a balance of two forces or two phenomena, that which of the two components is more absorbed or less absorbed or more soluble in the mobile phase or less soluble in the mobile phase. So depending upon the balance of the two, the components move to different heights along with the mobile phase and get separated ultimately. This is the principle behind this. This is a silica gel coated metal plate. You can see at the back side, metal is there on which a thin layer of silica gel has been coated. So you can also see a line here which I have already marked by using this a scale and a pencil, and this is for the measurement of the strip which I require for the experiments. So whatever measurement of the strip is needed, how long or how broad the strip is needed for a particular experiment, is cut from this sheet. I'll just keep it aside, and here you can see I have already cut this much piece of the thin layer silica gel coated metal plate. I'll show you the back side again for this also from the same sheet I've just shown you. So in the next step we have to place marks on it, marks of the spots of the mixture to be separated and analyzed. I'll take this pencil, take this scale and mark here a reference line on this strip. You can see a line here. I have marked this line. This is the reference line, and I'll be putting the spots of the mixture on this line. These are the samples of the mixtures we have already prepared, and I will very carefully put a spot of this mixture on this reference line very carefully. You can see a spot here.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, is there is any precaution needed to put the spot on the paper?
Yes, you have to do it very carefully on the reference line. Use a very little amount of the sample so that it does not spread. Let it allow to evaporate the solvent in which the mixture has already been taken. And in case you need little more to be put, you can have a second spot right on the top of it, like this. This is my sample A. We will take another sample, which is sample B, already prepared. Here, another mixture, and put its spot also. We will be doing two mixtures simultaneously. Again, very carefully, a very small spot is to be placed here. You can see here. I'll allow this to dry a little. And we have also reference sample here. The spot of this reference sample will be placed in the center of the two spots A and B. And when we will be separating these mixtures, you will find an interesting result about that. So wait for that. Let me put the spot for this. So this is the spot for the standard or the reference compound. So you can see here that there are three spots on this strip, and two of them are of samples A and B, which are two mixtures, and in the center there is another spot pinkish in color, which is the reference spot. So when we will develop this plate for separation, you will find a very interesting result. So spots A and B on the left and right are of two mixtures. The components will get separated when we will develop this plate, and compound C you will see which will match with some of the compounds either in A or in B. So that's the standard reference we have taken here. You can also see here that this plate is now hung by a hook which is put in this cork. So as it is, I will be putting this silica gel coated strip bearing the spots of the sample mixture into a development chamber and let it be there for some time so that separation is allowed to happen. Here we have this development chamber. You can see here that there is a mobile phase we have taken, a suitable solvent, and then very carefully I will put this metal strip coated with silica gel into this chamber. Very carefully without touching the walls, you can see here, and also at the bottom that it should slightly dip into the solvent. Is it okay? Without touching the walls and the bottom dipping very slightly in the solvent, we will now let it remain as such undisturbed, and slowly you will see that as the mobile phase moves up, along with that components of mixture will also get slowly moving upwards. They will raise up, so they will go up along with the mobile phase. The component which is more soluble will move faster along with the mobile phase, and the one which is less soluble will remain little lower than the upper one because that may be more adsorbed on the silica gel, you can say on the spot side. So different rates of mobility of these spots or the components in the mixture determine there. So you will see that different components rise to different heights on the plate when they are allowed to be there undisturbed for some time. This is because of different solubilities of these components in the mobile phase. So we will just let it be like this for a few minutes and we will keep watching this continuously. So you can see here that the solvent has moved to a sufficient height and we can take this plate out from this chromatography jar. See, I am marking a line here where a solvent has moved like this. I have made a point here. You can see here that I have marked the solvent front, that is the level to which the solvent has moved. Now I will let this plate dry and leave it for few minutes, and after that we will go to calculate the RF value of different components of these mixtures which have separated here. Now you can see that this silica gel strip with the separated compounds have dried, and we have already marked the mark for the solvent front with a pencil before the solvent has evaporated. So you can see here that we had taken two mixtures A and B, and in the center we put a known compound as a reference standard compound, which was pink in color, and we labeled it as C on the strip. And you can easily see that each of the mixtures has separated into different components, and such a separated you can say strip containing multiple compounds or compounds at various places on the strip is called a chromatogram. So we have developed this chromatogram and have obtained separated components of each of the mixtures. And very interesting thing to find here with respect to compound C, which was placed in the center, was that if we have something as a known compound, we can always place it along with the mixture of unknown compounds. And after the development of this chromatogram, we can say that what compounds were present in a particular mixture. So here you can see that there is a pink colored compound, which was standard compound here, and in this mixture you can see that corresponding this spot for pink color has appeared. So that means that compound C was present in this mixture also, which has separated. So that's how we compare the compounds. But how do we really do it and say it very correctly and very accurately is to first determine the RF values for particular components, which means that for each of the separated components, we calculate the RF value. Now, what is RF value? It is R capital written with F as a subscript at its bottom. So that means R is retention, F is factor. So RF value is retention factor for a particular compound. It is also called the retardation factor. So it can be obtained if we have this distance of the solvent front, which we measure right from this baseline using the scale. And as you can see, the distance moved by the solvent from this line to this point is 7.4, right? And we will now similarly label the spots as P, Q, R and S. I am able to see here 4 spots, and you can also see clear 4 spots in the separated mixture. This orange brown spot is that of compound P, let us say. Next, below this there is a bluish compound, bluish component, which is separated. Let this be the component R. Down there is a, in this sample, pinkish spot. Let us label this as the component Q. And this is now the last spot here, component S. Right? So P, R on this, Q on the other side as pink, and S here in the bottom. So if we want to calculate for each of these spots the RF values, we calculate it by using the formula that in the numerator we keep the distance traveled by a particular spot from here to the center of the spot. And then we divide that distance by the distance traveled by the solvent front, right? Distance traveled by a particular spot divided by the distance traveled by the solvent front. Here solvent front has moved a distance 7.4 centimeter, and if we measure the distance of this orange spot, which was spot P here, we can write it as P. The distance moved here is 6.8. So for the calculation of RF value for spot P or compound P, we have to divide 6.8 by 7.4, and then we will be getting its RF value. Similarly, for this compound R, which was bluish in nature, here the distance traveled by this spot from this reference line is 6.4 centimeter. So to calculate the distance traveled by this spot, we will take 6.4 as the numerator and then divide by that distance traveled by the solvent front. So 6.4 divided by 7.4 will give its RF value, right? And now for this pink spot, which was spot Q, we labeled as Q. RF can be calculated as, if I see here, the distance at the center of the spot will be 5.5 centimeter. So it has traveled a distance of 5.5 centimeter. In the numerator, we'll keep that value, and in the denominator will be the distance traveled by the solvent front, which is 7.4. And we can calculate its RF value also. Similarly, for this bluish compound also, which is little bit elongated, but we will take the center of the spot to measure the distance, and here it is spot S, and distance traveled is exactly 2 centimeter. So to calculate the RF value for compound S, we will divide 2.0 centimeter by 7.4 centimeter. So let us do the calculations. We have all our distances with us. Now we have got all the four spots separated as P, Q, R and S, and we have already noted down the distances traveled by these spots, and hence by the formula of RF is equal to distance traveled by a particular spot divided by the distance traveled by the solvent front, we can calculate the RF value of each of these spots or the compounds which have been separated from the mixture. So Shailja, have you calculated the RF values?
Yes, ma'am.
Which compounds?
Ma'am, P and R.
Okay, tell me the values.
Ma'am, since RF is the distance traveled by compound over the distance traveled by solvent.
Very good.
For brown, the distance traveled was 6.8. Mm-hmm. Then RF is equals to 6.8 over 7.4. So it came out to be
0.91 for compound P.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And for compound R, which was blue in color, the distance traveled by the compound blue was 6.4. So the RF came out to be 0.86.
For compound R.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What about you, Satinder? Have you also calculated the RF values?
Yes, ma'am. I have also calculated the retention factor value for compound Q and compound S. For compound Q, the retention factor value will be equal to distance traveled by the compound Q divided by the distance traveled by the solvent, that is solvent front.
Good.
Which will be equal to 5.5 divided by 7.4, and it comes to be 0.74.
Okay.
Similarly, for compound S, it will be equal to distance traveled by the compound S divided by the solvent front, which comes out to be 2.0 divided by 7.4, and it will be equal to
0.21. Yes, that's the RF for compound S. Okay. So students, you must have enjoyed today doing this experiment on thin layer chromatography, and you know that we have separated the components of a mixture and then calculated the RF values for the individual separated compounds. And also by using a known standard spot for that particular component, when we separate the compounds of a mixture, we can know that whether that compound was present in a mixture or not, because the two RFs for the same spots will be same. The two spots, the for the known and the unknown in the sample of mixtures, will be appearing at the same height on the plate. And also, RF value is a characteristic value of a particular compound as much as a melting point or a boiling point is. So this is one of the characteristic properties which can be always related to the compound concerned. So we can always compare the RF values and say that whether the compound is present in a particular mixture or not, by comparing the colors also if they are colored compounds, right? So this was an interesting set of experiment on thin layer chromatography. We used the thin layer of adsorbent on the plate, and we used a ready-made plate for that, in which silica gel was coated on the metal plate already. We bought that ready-made plate. But what will happen if the plate is not available, the ready plate is not available in the market, or you have some crisis for resources, or you don't have money to purchase that? In that case, we can also prepare by a very simple method the plate for thin layer chromatography experiment. What we do here is we take two glass plates, right, and then put them together, hold them together, and in a beaker we make a solution of silica gel for chromatography, which is a powdered form of silica gel. We dissolve that in a mixture of alcohol and water and make a thick paste of silica gel in alcohol and water. Then we will be carefully dipping the two plates, glass plates, by holding them in our one hand in the beaker containing the silica gel paste, right, so that a thick layer of coating is formed on the both plates, one side of each plate. Which sides? The outer sides of both the plates.
Yes.
We will take them out very carefully so that we don't have extra silica gel dripping out from that. Carefully separate the plates, the two plates. They are still wet because solvent is still there. On the other side where the silica gel has been, you can say, layered on the glass plate. So we have to dry them. We dry these plates in an oven, already preheated oven, normal ovens which are there in the laboratory. We put the plates on the wire of the oven inside and let it be heated for maybe 20 to 30 minutes. All the solvents get evaporated and you will be getting a dry plate containing thin layer of silica gel on the glass plate. So that is very simple method of preparation of TLC plates by your own way, you can say, in a simple way in the laboratory, in case you don't have such ready-made plates. So that's how you can do simple things and do the experiments which you want to do yourself without any bothering for money or availability of all such setups. So it's a very simple experiment which anybody can perform in the laboratory. Take out some pigments or mixture or whatever you have handy compounds in the kitchen, maybe turmeric and all colorful compounds, you can separate by using this technique. I hope you liked
yes,
this experiment very well.
Yes,